Good morning. Have any of you guys seen Will anywhere? Anyone see him around? There's plenty of room on this riser over here. Yeah, so this morning, Will told me he was going to anchor with me, you know? So we got here early, and we saw all these fun Armor of God pieces sitting out here. So we started using them. I picked this one right here, the shield. Who remembers what the shield stands for? Shield of Faith. That's right, Shield of Faith. And I was going to talk about how, you know, this Shield of Faith relates to Paul's story today. And Will picked the Shoes of Peace to talk about, but I literally can't find him anywhere. We started playing, you know, hide and go seek this morning, which was pretty fun, hiding with the pieces. Huh? No, guys, come on. We gotta listen. Listen up. We're going to go through the timeline. It'll be out. What? This box? Oh, wow, that's heavy. Oh, Will!
Oh, hey.
I found you!
What's up?
Wow, how long have you been in there?
Like 4.5 hours.
Wow, you seriously went out hide and go seek. That is the best
thanks.
Hiding spot ever.
Yeah.
Wow, how'd you even flip that thing on top of you?
I really don't know, and I kind of pinched my toes in the process, too.
Oh, I'm sorry. Are you okay?
No, I'm probably going to have to go to the ER.
Oh, okay. Yeah. We can do that later.
Yeah, probably.
Well, I was just starting to explain the timeline to them all when I found you.
Yeah, mm-hmm. That's good that you found me. It was really very uncomfortable in there.
Oh, it was?
Yeah, I'm going to have to go to the chiropractor, and also, like, my hip was cramping up so bad, and I don't even know if I can move it now.
Wow, how'd you survive in there for 4.5 hours?
Well, you see, I was wearing these shoes of peace.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so even though it was, like, terrible and uncomfortable, and I'm probably going to have, like, months and months of doctor's appointments now to fix my body after that, like my toes and my hip and my neck, it was, you know, I was able to get through it because of God's peace that helped me through with these shoes.
Yes, yeah. Exactly like what you were going to say about the story today.
Yeah.
Exactly. You can relate it to the story.
Yeah.
All right, if we can get our zoomed in timeline right here. We're talking about Paul's joy in prison. Will, do you think prison was more uncomfortable than that box?
You know, having experienced the box for 4.5 hours and considering that Paul was in prison for, you know, years and years and years, and that there was probably also wetness in prison and rats and smells that I didn't really have in the box, I'd say that the prison was probably more uncomfortable. But will say that Paul's hip was probably fine. He probably had enough room to extend his leg.
All right, well, in prison, what did Paul have with him that you're talking about right now?
Well, he also had God's peace with him, which helped him to get through that very, very difficult situation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so Paul's joy in prison, he was able to choose joy in that because he also had faith. He had all these armor pieces with him, the shield of faith like we were talking about. He had faith in God. That's why he was able to choose joy, because he knew what he was fighting for and knew what he believed in. And he had peace as well in his Lord, like Will was talking about.
Mm-hmm.
And we are going to hear more about that from our storyteller right now. So let's welcome her while I guess I get Will to the ER.
Hello, Nipperkins! Hello! And happy Valentine's Day! What? 4th of July! Oh, I'm getting so old. Time just runs by like an ostrich. An ostrich can run 45 miles an hour, you know. That's pretty fast. Can you run 45 miles an hour? Granny Gert can't do that. I've got a bad hip, you know. I can run half a mile an hour. But ostriches can run 45 miles an hour, you know. Did you know that? They can't fly. Oh, well, I didn't come here to talk about ostriches, though. I came to tell you a story. Do you want to hear one? Of course you do. Oh, I gotta get to my rocking chair, though. Take the stairs. You don't think Granny can do this, do you? I'm stuck. James, can you help a poor lady? Can you help a poor old lady? Somebody come help Granny Gert. Somebody, yes, come help me. Please, I must get you my rocket. Okay. Thank you. Granny's got this. Okay. Okay. Get ready for this story. Settle down, Nipperkin, settle down, because I'm going to tell you a tale about a chef. Chef Louis. Okay, let me see. Okay. Shh. There once was a French chef named Louis who loved beef Wellington. Yes. Actually, he more than loved beef Wellington. He was obsessed with it. So, when the host of the television show, Let's Get Cooking, wanted to dedicate one of his episodes to beef Wellington, he could think of nobody better than Louis to be the guest star. Ladies and gentlemen, let's give a warm round of applause for the one, the only, Chef Louis. The host cried when the cameras were rolling live. Thank you for having me on this show today. Louis waved to the audience. I will be teaching you how to prepare the most succulent meal you will ever have in your lives. It is the incredible beef Wellington from my home country, France. That sounds delicious, the host declared. Chef Louis wasted no time introducing the ingredients and equipment needed to make the dish. As he spoke, an irritating baby's cry, wah, resonated from the audience. Louis didn't notice and kept on teaching. The host did notice but tried to ignore it. Over several minutes, the baby grew angrier and louder. The host was a professional and determined to maintain his stage persona until the baby calmed down. The baby, who did not care about beef Wellington or about how his volume was affecting the show, did not calm down, however. Instead, he hollered even louder. The host finally lost control, covered his ears, and shouted, "Somebody remove that baby!" The embarrassed mother quickly gathered up her things and left the studio. The host shook his head once or twice as if to dump out the noise. His hair looked a bit crazy after he did so. Surprisingly, Chef Louis hadn't noticed any of this and kept right on cooking with a happy grin. The host regained composure and tried to return his focus to the recipe. He almost accomplished this before another interruption came. A clown from the studio next door that aired a children's show had gotten loose and burst onto their set. He rode a unicycle round and round while honking his nose. The host panicked and began chasing the clown. Some of the audience whispered, and the rest laughed as they watched this unexpected occurrence. After about 5 laps around the island where Chef Louis was cooking, the host finally tackled the clown. He ripped off his nose and threw it as far as he could before the security guards came and escorted him off the set as quietly as manageable. The host rejoined Chef Louis' side, out of breath, and covered in white and red clown face paint. The chef didn't even so much as look over at him. He was too intent on showing the audience how to correctly tie up the beloved beef Wellington with butcher's twine. The host felt very thankful that he was working with a chef who was so professional and that the show had not been ruined too much. Just as he finished panting from his exercise in clown chasing, he smelled an alarming smell. From behind him, the host spun around and saw smoke rising up out of one of the wall ovens. He raced to open the door and set free. Furious flames of fire. The audience gasped, and some raced out of the studio. The host began opening up every cupboard around him to locate a fire extinguisher. When he finally found one, he sprayed. He sprayed the fire down until the oven was filled with a mound of white dust. The host, now covered in both black smoke from the fire and white dust from the fire extinguisher, came to Chef Louis' side just as he was giving his final instructions. And after you brush the pastry gently with the egg whites, you will put it in the oven at 425 degrees for 40 minutes or until the meat reads 125 degrees Fahrenheit. I have one finished deal to show you. Voila! You see? Mwah. Yes, it is succulent and delightful. It is truly the best meal you will ever enjoy. The chef concluded before turning to the host. Thank you for having me today, he said cheerfully. The host, with crazy hair, skin stained with clown paint, and clothing covered in black and white soot, blinked in disbelief. The only thing he could think to do was to turn towards the nearest camera, still rolling live, and answer, "You're welcome." Immediately, the director called, "Cut!" The camera crew began to take care of their equipment, and the remaining few audience members left. The host let out a deep sigh of relief and dusted himself off as best he could, then turned to Chef Louis. "What a show! I cannot believe everything we've been through in the last 20 minutes. Chef Louis, I cannot thank you enough for being here. I'm sorry your first show was like this. Tell me, how are you feeling right now?" Chef Louis looked at the host and thought for a moment. "Honestly, I feel very good. This is not the best beef Wellington I ever had, but..." The chef took one large bite from the plate in front of him. "But it is delicious. I give it an 8. The end. Well, Nipper kids, I hope you liked the story today. It's one of my favorite Valentine's Day stories. Yes, now, maybe next time I come, I can read you another. Everybody say bye-bye to Granny Gert. Do I have any firecrackers out there? All right. Well, I'm not surprised because, as you know, it is the 4th of July. Happy Independence Day. Can you say that? Awesome. Good job. Well, how did you like Granny Gert's story? You liked her story? Wasn't that Chef Louis so obsessed with beef Wellington? Isn't that crazy? No matter what happened around him, he was just focused on cooking that beef, wasn't he? That kind of reminds me of somebody else I know. A real apostle, a real live apostle from the true Bible story, Apostle Paul. He was obsessed with something else too, but something way more important than beef Wellington. The Apostle Paul was obsessed with the gospel. Who here knows what the gospel is? Huh? I saw your hand in the back pop up. Tell us, what is the gospel? The gospel is God. That's a great answer. Can somebody give me a little more detail, though? Yes, what's the gospel? The gospel is the Bible. Another great answer. One more. Gospel. God's word. Yes, exactly. But really, when you hear the word gospel, think of the story of Jesus. Think of the good news. Jesus coming down to earth and being born as a baby, and then later dying on the cross for what? Our sins. And giving us the free gift of eternal life. That means living forever with him in heaven. That's the gospel news. So when we talk about the gospel, basically we're talking about that whole story that's available for everyone. When you share the gospel, you are sharing the story of Jesus Christ and how we can be rescued from our sins. And that was what Paul was obsessed with. He wasn't obsessed with Beef Wellington. He was obsessed with the gospel. He was. Now, where did I go? That reminds me of our big question. Can we have our big question up on there? I want to see if you guys know the answer to this. You've been working on it for a couple of weeks now. When should we tell others about Jesus? When should we tell others the gospel? All the time. I heard it. Sorry, you guys are answering all at the same time. Let's say it together, shall we? We should always tell others about Jesus, even when it's difficult. Now, thinking about the Apostle Paul, did the Apostle Paul have some difficult times? He absolutely did. And you've been learning about that the last few weeks. Let's recap, shall we? Because it's been difficult thing after difficult thing after difficult thing. It really has been. So number one, when Paul went to the temple in Jerusalem, a riot started. Because there were people there that didn't like the gospel, didn't like what Paul was doing, and they were mad at him, and a riot started. And it got so dangerous that the Roman soldiers had to arrest Paul to keep him safe, just to keep him safe. That was a hard, difficult thing, don't you think? Yeah, okay. Thing number one. Thing number two, after the Romans arrested him, those Jewish people that didn't like Paul didn't give up. They started plotting a plan. They were going to murder him. Murder him. That's right. His life was in danger. So the Roman soldiers got wind of this, and they're like, we have to move him to another city. Not only that, we have to move him in the middle of the night, secretly, to Caesarea. That was a difficult thing, don't you think? Put that in the pile. Whoo! Doesn't stop there, though, does it? Because while he was in Caesarea, he was put in prison. And he had to defend himself. He didn't do anything wrong. But over and over and over again, he had to tell his story. Right? One of the governors wanted to hear his story over and over again. In fact, he called him out of prison to talk to him for 2 years, over and over again. That's a long time to tell the same story. I think that's difficult, don't you? That's a long time. All right, then after that, Paul finally appealed to Caesar. And we know that that means I want Caesar to decide what happens to me. I don't want the Jews to decide, and I don't want you guys to decide. I want to see Caesar. And where was Caesar? In Rome. That's right, because he is the leader of Rome. So Paul had to travel to Rome, and he had to go on a boat. What happened to this boat? Yeah. It crashed, right? Big storm, and the boat crashed. What happened? They got shipwrecked. That's a hard thing. Okay, well, it didn't stop there, though, right? Because when they found land, the Roman soldiers that were in charge of all these prisoners were like, these guys are going to run away. We're going to get in trouble. Our heads are on the line. Caesar's not going to be happy. We better just kill all the prisoners so that they don't run away. I don't know where the logic is in that, but they thought, we'll just kill them all. Paul had to use some words of wisdom to keep that from happening. But that was a hard thing, don't you think? Wouldn't that be scary? That'd be scary. That's a hard thing. Whew. Okay, next hard thing. What's this? Snake. What happened? Paul got bit by a snake. Not just any old little garden snake. This snake has poison in his mouth. And what'd Paul do? He just shook it off. But that was still hard. Probably hurt, don't you think? Oh, man. All right. Now, and finally,
Paul makes it to Rome. After all this time, he makes it to Rome, and he's waiting to meet with Caesar, and he's waiting in jail. You think jail would be fun? No, it is definitely a difficult thing, to be sure. Wow, look at all that. That is a lot. Woo! So, while Paul was in prison in Rome, one of the churches that he started in Philippi was really worried about him, okay? Other Christians that he told the gospel to, far away in Philippi, not in Rome, heard that he was in jail, and they got really worried. Now, here's the thing. They didn't have email back then. They didn't have cell phones. They couldn't just call Paul up on his cell phone and go, hey, you okay? Is there anything we can do for you? How can we pray? They can't do that. So they had to send somebody to travel and journey far to Paul. They sent someone named Epaphroditus. Can you guys say that? That's a big name. Epaphroditus, well done. So Epaphroditus traveled to Paul, and he asked, Paul, how are you doing? We're worried about you. And Paul decides he's going to send a letter with Epaphroditus. He writes a big, long letter to go back to Philippi. What do you think he wrote about in his letter? Do you think he said, it's been a hard couple years, and I'm exhausted? You think he said that? Nope. Do you think he said, my snake bite is really bugging me, keeps me up at night? Think he said that? I'm discouraged. I'm super discouraged. I'm lonely here in prison. Do you think he said that? Nope. No. You know what? Paul's letter didn't contain hardly anything about himself. Let's look at what the Bible, the true word of God, says in Philippians 1, 12 through 14. It says, I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel. And that means the word of Jesus Christ and his story and his free gift is spreading. Everything that's happened to me is spreading the word so that it has become known throughout the whole imperial guard and to all the rest that my imprisonment is for Christ. And most of the brothers, having become confident in the Lord by my imprisonment, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. So what does Paul talk about? He talks about the gospel of Jesus Christ. He's obsessed with the gospel, just like Chef Louis was obsessed with what? Beef Wellington. Beef Wellington is a lot less important than the gospel of Jesus Christ. I would say Paul is obsessed with the right thing, wouldn't you? But yeah, he's been through all this, and yet he's focused on the gospel. Let's look at another thing. In Philippians 1, verse 18 through 19, we not only see that he is focused on the gospel and not himself, but that he's rejoicing. What'd I say? I think you can say that louder. Nice. Nice. It says, Christ is proclaimed, and in that I rejoice. Yes, and I will rejoice. For I know that through your prayers and the help of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, this will turn out for my deliverance. Paul has been through all this hard stuff, and he's rejoicing. What? Everybody go, wow. Wow. I'm not hearing a lot of wows. Give me a wow. There we go. Okay. So, he's rejoicing because he's obsessed with the job of spreading the news of Jesus Christ and his gift of free salvation. It's so important to him. And these hard things gave him opportunities to tell others about Jesus. When he was sent to Caesarea, he got to tell others about Jesus. When he was on that boat, he got to tell the guards and the other prisoners about Jesus. And when he was bit by the snake, they were like, wow. This guy survived the snake bite. He's from God. We can trust him. When he was almost murdered, it put him in the path to Rome. And now he's in prison, but he's going to get to speak to Caesar and a bunch of other people and tell them the gospel. And that he's rejoicing about. Crazy. Well, Paul didn't have to necessarily enjoy these things. Is it okay to not be okay with these hard things? He doesn't have to like them. They're hard. But you know what? Even though they were hard, instead of complaining and focusing on the bad, he took his pain to God. And he trusted God to help him through anything and everything. He trusted him, even though he knew while he was in prison, he could very likely be executed. He might lose his life. Caesar might hear what he has to say and be like, off with his head. That could happen. And you know what? He trusted God, and he still had joy because he knew that even if he died, where was he going to go? He was going to go be with Jesus. Let's look at another verse. Philippians 1, verse 21. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Wow. Paul believed, and he rejoiced because he knew whether he's on earth spreading the gospel or whether he's in heaven with Jesus, he's blessed, and God is in control. Pretty awesome. Can I have everybody stand? We're going to pray together, okay? Paul is an excellent, excellent example for us of focusing and being obsessed with the gospel of Jesus Christ and having joy, even when spreading the gospel is difficult. All right, get your wiggles out. Go like this. Get them out. And then two, one, still. Let's show God our respect and talk to him, shall we? All right. Dear Heavenly Father, we know that Paul wasn't perfect and he was human just like us, but I praise you for his amazing example. And I would ask that you would give us what we don't have, that you would put in our hearts a deep, burning zeal and a wisdom to spread the gospel, to know how to do it, when to do it, and to not be afraid of it even though it's hard and even when it is hard. And I also ask that you would put in us a joy for this. And a joy in trusting you, and a joy that if we believe in you, we get to be with you forever, no matter what difficult things happen to us here on earth. And I just pray that you would tuck these things away in the soil of these children's hearts, in my heart, and that you would help it to grow and yield a major crop. Bless everybody's 4th of July. Thank you for our independence. Amen. And everybody said, good job. Now we get to worship.
All right. Good morning, everybody. All right. I know you guys can do better than that. Good morning. Yes, that is what I like to hear. All right, so this morning we are going to worship, and so I'm going to have my helpers come up, if I can have Red 2 come up, and we're going to start the song right now while they come up, and we're all going to worship together, all right? So I see my helpers. Great, good.
I raise a hallelujah. I raise a hallelujah.
great, you guys. You guys did really good when you guys were speaking back to us, and I loved that. So we have been doing this verse for a couple of weeks now, and so I'm going to quickly review the motions with you guys, and then I'm going to have you all stand up, and we're going to say it together as loud as we can and do the motions, all right? So this is eager. You guys are going to put your hands together and rub them like this. You're really ready for something. And then for hope, you're going to bend your two hands like this, and then you're going to bring them up here and kind of wiggle them a little bit. And then for Christ, you guys should know Christ. Can you guys show me Christ? Good. You're going to make a C and draw a sash across your body. All right. And then for life, can you guys show me life? Good. You're going to draw an L up your body, life. And then for death, you're going to have your right hand up and your left hand down, and then you're going to flip them like this, death. All right, I'm going to have you guys all stand up, and we're going to say it as loud as we can and do the motions, all right? Okay. As it is my eager expectation and hope that I will not be at all ashamed, but that with full courage, now as always, Christ will be honored in my body, whether by life or by death. For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. And we can find that in Philippians 1, 20 through 21. All right, that was great, you guys. Now I have a quick question. Today is 4th of July, and when you think 4th of July, what do you think of?
Fireworks!
Fireworks! All right, that's what I think of too. And are fireworks small or are they big? They're big, they're huge. And when I see fireworks, I have a lot of joy. I'm really happy. I really like them. And you know what's even bigger and brings me even more joy? The love of God. It's great. And there's no other love like it. So I'm going to have you guys all stand up, and we are going to sing about that right now.
Your love is patient, your love is kind. You always break through for this heart of mine. Your love is pure like the morning light. There's no one like you that can give me life. And when my heart is broken from so many times I'm loved and lost, you sew me back together carefully, wonderfully.
There's no place I can hide that your love cannot find you. Run out of me.
this way.
So we learned about Paul today, and he went through a lot of very difficult situations. He had to travel around a whole lot, and back then traveling was very difficult and dangerous, and he got put in prison and was in some very uncomfortable situations. But here's the wonderful thing, is that even though in life we go through really difficult situations, there are lots of opportunities for God to give us peace to help us get through those situations. And here's the thing, is that peace doesn't take those situations away or make them less uncomfortable, but it does help us to get through them through the power of God. I think about Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane right before he's about to be crucified. He's in a very difficult situation. He has a lot of internal pain and he knows what's coming, but God is able to give him peace in that situation, and then that doesn't take away the pain and discomfort, but it does help him through that. So that's great. Oh, speaking of uncomfortable situations.
You guys, I found a squirt gun that works.
All right, let's go.
Who's excited for Wild Wednesday? Yeah. Church to make sure we are ready for Wild Wednesday. And I'm scared. That one is an amazing squirt gun that really works. And Will and I will be at every Wild Wednesday this week, and we would love to see you there. And as a treat, if you do come, you'll probably get to see Will act as a sheep at some point. So that would be super, super exciting. All right, so tell your parents to sign you guys up for Wild Wednesday. Ah, and you're dismissed to your small groups.